So I get asked all the time, hey Bill, what do you think about this Bitcoin thing? And you know what? In this video, I'm gonna have to be honest with you. As if, what's my other option? That I normally would lie to you? But honestly, I spend about 1 hour a day, if not two, studying, reading, watching videos about Bitcoin, trading Bitcoin. I'd say I'm obsessed. And this obsession probably overtook me about 3 years ago. I remember when Bitcoin, as you guys can see in this chart, when Bloomberg called Bitcoin a bubble, they're like, oh, that's it. It's a bubble, 30 bucks, back down to 15, 10, game's over, nice try. When my students would always ask me, hey, Mr. Stenzel, what do you think about this Bitcoin thing? And I'm like, oh man, they just use that for drugs and illegal stuff. You don't stay away from that, kids. Then I was actually shocked. I couldn't believe it, that this drug money was actually valued more than the dollar. I was watching it when it hit a dollar and I'm thinking, the world has gone mad. But then as years progressed, hey, these mad people seem kind of normal. And in this video, I'm gonna talk to you everything Bitcoin in my little obsessed head, even though it probably won't get any views. This is a business channel, it's a finance channel, and you need to understand this because whether you like it or not, it's gonna be in your life forever. I honestly could care less about the price. I care more so about what it does. If you follow this channel for long enough, you know a lot of times I go after the scams, the scammers, the people that drive around in the Bentleys that trademark their name, which isn't their name, but then use it against you if you ever use their name, or they sit on top of Lamborghinis and they flash their dollars. I'm actually gonna go after one of the biggest scams in the history of the world. And if you don't already know, it's the central bank. Let me show you this. So as you guys can see here, here's silver. Here's cryptocurrency. Here's the biggest companies in the entire world as comparative in little blocks. Here's the 50 most richest people in the world. Hey, looky there. This is where I live, California. The Fed's balance sheet, currency, gold. We all like gold, right? Or the stock market in little boxes, just to show you the size of what we have to deal with. Here's the global debt problem. Not bad at all, but it gets worse. And last but not least, derivatives. How about that one? Good old derivatives, where you could just create something and then everyone gets to buy the one thing. How about that? And that's what central banks have been doing for quite a long time. When you deposit your 100 in your bank account and it gets deposited in lots of bank accounts all over the world. Or you take one little piece of gold, GLD, and you buy the derivative that's held by HSBC. Oh, that's nice. Make sure that they take care of your money, except I think they just laid off 30,000 people, was it? 35,000? A lot. 3,000? 35,000 people? Oh, this chart still keeps going. Look, Mom, no hands. We have a problem. The banks have created a massive nuclear bomb. What's our little friend down here? There's Bitcoin. So, do I think Bitcoin is going to solve a lot of problems? I do. Do I think it's going to create a lot of problems? I do. But in this video, I'm going to explain to you why I feel that Bitcoin is one of the greatest inventions that this world in your lifetime or your kid's lifetime will ever see. And why do I say that? It's because it holds people accountable. There will be no more $50 billion a day, $100 billion a day, just shoveled into the banks where we don't know which banks get it, what they're doing with it. But Bill, it's called liquidity. The banks need $100 billion a day of liquidity. Why? Did they run out? And who has to pay for all of this said liquidity, this glitch that happened, all of the QEs of money printing? That would be you. You, the people. We the people have to pay for the sins of our governments that just decide to be totally not controlled and print into oblivion. What happens if you decide, you know what, I'm not buying this stuff? You go to jail. You don't pay your taxes, you go to jail. So pay your taxes, kids. And the rich will continue to get rich, the middle class will shrink, and the poor will continue to get poorer. It's sad because the people that need to know about Bitcoin are the ones that are having to work one job, two jobs, three jobs. They don't have time to do market research and to study Bitcoin and if they should be buying it and what are the risks, the advantages, the disadvantages. What if it goes to zero? And if you disagree with me, that is perfectly fine. I can honestly say Bitcoin doesn't care. It's just simply about supply and demand. And if you don't have it, you're gonna wish you did. And we're starting right now. Wow, so who is this guy, this Bitcoin guy? Well, it really doesn't matter who I am because this channel is about you and helping you do three things. One, well, primarily two things. Start a business. And then with that said business, you invest it in things like Bitcoin, in stocks, in assets that will actually grow your bottom line. And then lastly, how to protect it. Because if you don't protect it, you're gonna lose it. So consider subscribing so I can help you every single week, three videos a week, two videos a week. If you click up here, down there, probably every day, you can go back and watch all my videos. They are perfectly free. But in this video, I'm gonna give you 10, if not 20 different things on why you should have Bitcoin in your portfolio as soon as possible. Because back in the day when they would say, hey, Sonny, you should save your money, that was great because you had savings account that was what, 10%, 15%, CDs at 18%. Wouldn't that be nice if we could have sound money that you can put in a savings account and actually passive income grow it? Oh my gosh, I wouldn't even have to invest. I wouldn't even have a channel anymore if our savings accounts were paying us 18%. But let me give you the why. You want to know, Bill, I just don't know. I'm scared. And number one, it's hard money. Bitcoin is hard money. You're like, I don't know what hard money is. What do you mean hard money? Like gold. It's difficult to get. Bitcoin is difficult to get. And it's getting even more difficult to get. Currently, it takes about 6,000, now don't quote me exactly on the penny, but roughly $6,300 to mine one Bitcoin. After the halving, it's gonna double that. So it's gonna cost miners $12,000-$15,000 to mine a Bitcoin, somewhere between 10 and 15. What do I think that what's gonna happen with the price? Well, it's kind of gonna do what it's been doing for the last 11 years and move in that direction over a long period of time. One of your best performing assets, if not the best performing asset in the last 11 years. So it is hard money like gold, like silver, like Bitcoin. Number two is it is secured hard money. Secured, private keys, can't hack, can't get at it. It's digital. This is crazy. Like, break into my house, take my gold. Break into my house, can't take my Bitcoin because I have it stored in my head. So I can access it at any time that I want with my private keys. And number three is the government hates it. Hate it. They can't print it. Dang it. Well, the one downside is that darn derivatives market. I wanted to show you that video of the derivatives market. And just like gold, GLD, you don't actually own the gold. You own GLD, which is a derivative of gold, but I'm sure HSBC has all of that gold. Number four, there is very little of it. There's only 21 million and probably 5 million lost their keys. So you have an advantage over just about everyone, but it is limited. Just like gold is limited and gold costs money to remove out of the earth, so does Bitcoin. I mean, 21 million, what is that? That's nothing in comparative to what the banks are moving around daily or printing daily. Or, you know, hey, in this repo market, I just gave HSBC 50 billion, and billion is way bigger than a million. So if you just happen to have a little bit of one of those Bitcoins, I would think that your life will be very good in the future. Number five, it can't be debased. And if you're like, Bill, what is this debase you're talking about? Is it snowboarding? No, it is not that debased. It's where you take a currency, let's say we're using silver, and you start chopping a little bit out of it. You start adding other metals, like what we've done with all of our currencies. Nothing is real. Like, everything is just fake. It's just paper. That's it. And governments always do this, and they sneak it in there. They start with, well, we're gonna back our currency with gold. And then in 1971, they're like, you know what? We're gonna remove that. We don't really need to back our currency with gold, or they would take the gold and again, they would debase it by using other metals. Some say that is the reason why Rome fell. And number six, the cost structure and how it's all set up is beautiful. Secured, it every so many years, it gets cut in half, which now brings the demand higher, you have the supply. It's a perfect world of deflationary assets and currency. And number seven, one of my favorite, is it's not centralized. You know how governments, everything's centralized. Well, every currency is centralized. Bitcoin, it's not centralized. It is we the people, you right there. You can give it to someone in Africa. You can, someone from Africa can give it to someone in England. Like, it doesn't care. It's borderless. If you have a phone, it works. It's decentralized and it's not controlled by the government, which they're going to do everything in their power to try to control it because they need to be in control. It needs to be centralized. Everything needs to be centralized with governments because they got to fight those bad people. And number eight, it's fungible. You could break a Bitcoin down into 1/10,000. I believe it's 1/10,000 of a Bitcoin. A dollar? It's 100. A penny. That's it. As far as you go. A Bitcoin? It's digital and it just keeps on going. Number nine, no marketing. Bitcoin has spent $0 on marketing and it just happens to be the best. So people are like, oh, well, you have so many different cryptos out there. Which one's the best? Well, which one is decentralized, does no marketing, one of the first, and in my opinion, probably one of the greatest. Number 10, it's intrinsic value. So many things intrinsically that Bitcoin offers. Number 11, let me give you the set, because some of you are like, no, it's not money. You can't call that money. Well, let's look at the characteristics of money, and then you could decide whether or not it's money or not. Number one, durability. Is your said currency durable? Your paper fiat currency, is that durable? No. What, do they go through a dollar bill within a year or two? They have to shred it and give you a new one. Yes, it's digital. It is forever durable. Number two, is it portable? You got to make sure that your said money is portable. Now, I would say gold is kind of portable. Silver is kind of portable. I wouldn't recommend getting on a plane with, 50, 100 pounds of silver. I wouldn't recommend it. So is Bitcoin portable? And the answer is absolutely yes. You can carry it around in your head all day long. You got your private keys. And that's it. Doesn't get more portable than just you. Number three, divisible. Can you divide it? Yes, I already went over that. Number four, uniformity. Is it all the same? It is all the same. Five, it has a limited supply of only 21 million. Not like your dollar, which has an unlimited supply. They can print as much as they want. They can put as many digits on a screen, on a bank screen, all day long with no repercussions. Well, except for inflation, if you like that stuff. Which Bitcoin is deflationary because it gets cut in half. Your dollar is inflationary. And hopefully you've taken advantage of some of this inflation from the banks where they pour money into the banking system and it balloons assets like the housing market and the stock market. Have you been taking advantage of that over the last 10 years? And number six, is it generally accepted? And I would say right now, I will take it. I don't know too many people that wouldn't take it. They're like, hey, you know what? You want this Bitcoin? Nah, I don't need it. And number seven, is it a store of value, of wealth? And as you know, over the last 11 years, the answer is yes. It has stored its value. You look at the currency, our current currency, our dollar? No, it has not. It originally cost $1 to get into Disneyland. And I'm going there today, and it's going to cost $200 to get into Disneyland. I mean, with parking and whatnot. And you want to know what's going to happen with those prices? They're going that way. But Bill, I came here because you said it was going to go to $1 trillion. And I want to know, how do you come up with these numbers? And I come up with these numbers from a multiple different ways. One of them is Bitcoin stock to flow model. Here is the current live chart. And it goes all the way back to 2010, and you can follow it. And it has been accurate, pretty darn close to the T. It'll give you the stock to flow, priced at the end of the day, what it should be trading at, what it shouldn't be trading at. When it was at $19,065, that is actually when, and my kids made me prove it, They're like, let me see it. So I had to go into my account to show them that I sold at 17,000. I'm like, sorry guys, we are way out of where it should have been at that time, around 3,000 to 6,000. And it does come back to the means. And right now, if you look at what Bitcoin is at right now, it says it should be right around 8,500. And what's the price? We're currently at 9,000, you know, depends on the day. And that's about right. Now, in about, from this video, 90 days from now, 89 days from now, a little more than 2 months from now, the supply is going to get cut in half. Now, I'm just going to give you generally what I know in my head. Roughly, actually not roughly. Hey, Bill, why don't you just go to the website? Geez, you got a computer right in front of you. Just click. In 80 days, it is going to get cut in half. Currently, in Bitcoins in circulation, there is 18,230. And right now, there is 1,800 Bitcoins generated a day. And in 80 days, that number will be cut in half. So we're looking at 900 Bitcoin will be mined a day. And that is it. It is code. You ain't going to change it. And how long does it take for me to send you a Bitcoin? 10 minutes. Now you're like, hey, but I can't use that at Starbucks. Well, Bitcoin is the first layer. So think of it this way, like gold. Gold's the first layer. And then you could add layers on top of that, like the Lightning Network or like the Cash App or other different forms of payment, Visa, that just validate. Yep, it's there. We trust him. Go ahead and send it. Because trust me, your dollar has many layers. Bitcoin, you have Bitcoin. Yes, it takes 10 minutes, but that could be solved very quickly. And it takes 10 minutes because it needs to be validated and secured. This is one of the very first, actually the only, has been, the only currency that's ever been able to be on its own. It secures itself, it holds all the properties of money, and it's digital. But Bill, who even takes Bitcoin? Well, a lot of people. Oh, that's Subway. Some of the people that actually take Bitcoin is Microsoft, Expedia. Yes, you can actually mine Bitcoin right now from your home computer. I used to do that. I had 12 graphics cards. My wife's like, why is the upstairs always so darn hot? And then you can use that said money to buy, you know, to fly away. Go to Hawaii, AT&T, Burger King just started accepting it. KFC, Overstock, the Cash App, ATMs. You can go to ATMs and actually withdraw. You will definitely get hit with a higher fee. Would not recommend it. Virgin Galactic, Amazon, Twitter, if you buy gift cards through things like Purse.io. But this is just the beginning. That's the second layer. Right now, we're dealing with Bitcoin as the first layer. And is it a secured asset? Is it money? Actually, in my class today, I'm teaching about this. And I'm like, okay, guys, get out your phone. Let me send you some Bitcoin. You can actually, you're like, really? I'm like, yeah, you should be in my class. If you download the Cash App, I will leave a link in the description. I think they give you $5 or $7 or $10. Same thing I think Coinbase offers, but it's actually way easier. And in my opinion, for just the general, like, oh, I'll just use it, buy it, kind of things like that. Jack Dorsey created it. Let me show you. Here it is. Now you can invest. The Cash App actually allows you to invest in stocks. It allows you to, and Bitcoin, like, you actually have private keys. This is real. Robinhood is not. Here's Robinhood. And Robinhood is actually a derivative. So if you buy it on Robinhood, you own a derivative of Bitcoin. You do not get your own private key. That would be on places like the Cash App, which is pretty darn cool, in my opinion. Yes, they may charge a small fee, but it also costs a lot of money to mine and secure the network. But like I was saying before, the Cash App, you can download it. Pretty cool. They give you $5. And I guess I could say it helps the channel out. It's okay if you just want to go off on your own and not take the, I guess you wouldn't get the $5, would you? But you could sit there all day like $1, I'm going to buy $1 of Bitcoin. I think you would be pleasantly surprised in 10 years if you just did that, you know, every day, just $1, $2, whatever, instead of spending the money on coffee, which you really don't need. You could just buy yourself a Bitcoin. And one of my favorite things for Bitcoin, of why I'm a big proponent of it, is we have 7.5 billion people that are cut off from finance. and $5 billion are cut off from international finance. And in my opinion, and I have my own opinions, Bitcoin solves this. And the layers that will be built on top of the blockchain, on top of Bitcoin, you can't really build it on top of the blockchain, but on top of layer number one, now I can send someone in Africa, oh, you want, here's $20, buy yourself the cow or buy yourself, and they now have, now the unbanked become the banked. Imagine if you were, you didn't have access. You did not have access to money. You don't have access to your bank. They pay you, you just, what do you do with it? And a lot of people, we're talking billions, don't have access. Bitcoin, as long as you have a phone, which is crazy, you're like, wait, they don't have a bank, but they have a phone, that is correct. And if they have a phone, they can then transfer it to one, to another, secured, they are their own bank. There's no middlemen, there's no banks, there's no corruption. You don't even need a government. Shh. But governments don't like it. I don't know if you ever see the tweets, but obviously governments aren't going to like this because they can't control it. And what a government can't control, they're going to try to regulate it. And when you can't regulate, you can't, not with Bitcoin. And they're going to do everything that they can in their power to regulate this, to control this, to create their own. And I think it's just going to get worse. But I do believe people are dumb. And people are like, oh, you know, the T word, that's going to happen. Okay. Drug dealers, they're using it for drugs because they never use currency for drugs. Heaven forbid, that's never happened. Yes, governments are fearful of this. I don't care what they say. They're going to play it off like it's nothing. I can guarantee you the last 7 years, they've had stuff in the works to try to do what they can to still remain in control. But the banks are insolvent. They have a hard time paying their own, as you can see with the repo market. HSBC just laid off 35,000 employees. The cracks are there. And I remember this like clear as day, the 2007, 2008, 2009. I got out of my house October, sold it $1 million. I'm like, no, I'm going to bet against this one. I was very fortunate. I couldn't have reached the top any more than I got out at the top. I don't think it's going to happen this time. And I don't think that the taxpayers are going to buy it. And when these banks come to our government, right, we the people, and say, hey, you know what? We just need $1 trillion. Bail us out right now. Otherwise, the whole system collapses. Well, I guess we are just going to wait and see. But what came out of that, the ashes in 2007, 2008, was code, Bitcoin. In the next 3 months, Bitcoin should be between 8,003, 8,005. After we have the halving, you're looking at a $12,000 Bitcoin to 88,000. As it moves along into 2023, you're looking at over $100,000 Bitcoin. After 2024, we have another one. And that is where you see the legendary between $600,000 and $1.1 million for a price of one Bitcoin that you own. The stock to flow model has been highly accurate in the last 11 years. So shout out to Satoshi Nakamura. I just want to say thank you so much for making my life a whole heck of a lot better and hopefully my kids' life a lot better and giving it back to we the people. No taxation without representation, and I'll catch you in the next video.